Hey, 42 here. Even the most rugged and hardiest of men cry sometimes. There's no escaping the tear. In fact, studies suggest that you probably cry a lot more than you think you do. During a study by the German Society of Ophthalmology, they found that women cry on average between 30 to 64 times per year, whereas men cry between 6 and 17 times per year. Women are actually biologically hardwired to be more susceptible to crying. Women have 60% more prolactin in their bodies than men. Prolactin is a reproductive hormone which is also found in tears and is partially responsible for women being more prone to tearing up. On the other hand, testosterone, a hormone which is more abundant in males, inhibits crying. However, this difference in the frequency of tears shed between genders doesn't come into effect until the age of 13. Before they are 13, both girls and boys cry the same amount. Men and women don't just differ in how frequently they cry, they also cry for different durations. Studies show that men tend to cry for between 2 to 4 minutes, whereas women cry for an average of 6 minutes. Maybe this is why in almost every culture on earth, it is more socially acceptable for women to cry than men. Certain cultures actually shun crying altogether, for both genders, seeing it as undignified and infantile. Despite the negative connotations they may carry, tears are most certainly a force for good. They can call others to help you and even heal you from within. But why do humans cry in the first place? Let's find out. They may all look the same on the surface, but there are three different types of tears, and they're all quite unique. The first kind of tear is basal tears. In all mammals, the cornea of the eye is continually kept wet by basal tears. Our eyes are some of the most vulnerable and sensitive parts of our outer body, so it's incredibly important that they are protected at all times. The basal tears ensure our eyes are well protected from bacteria and irritants. Basal tears are made up of three distinct layers. The first layer, which sits directly on the eye surface, is the mucus layer. This helps the tear to spread out and coat the entire eyeball. It also keeps the eye moisturized. The next, the middle layer, is the aqueous layer. Consisting mostly of water, it contains vitamins and nutrients, keeping the cornea healthy. This layer also contains salt, which acts as an antibacterial. This is why tears taste salty. And the third, outermost layer is the lipid layer. This layer, made up entirely of oils, acts as a sealant to stop your tears evaporating and keeps bacteria and other irritants out. This layer also makes your vision sharp. The convex of this oily film which coats your cornea creates an incredibly smooth surface. This helps to smooth out the natural bumps and fissures of your cornea, which can cause blurred vision. This is why people get blurry vision when they have dry eyes. The second type of tear is the reflex tear. These are only released when foreign particles make contact with the eye, which could irritate or even damage the eye. For example, pepper spray, tear gas, capsicum, and of course, onion vapors. When these potentially harmful substances make contact with the cornea, reflex tears are produced to wash them away. And finally, the last kind of tear is what has perplexed scientists for so long, psychogenic tears. When we talk about someone crying, sobbing or weeping, we are usually referring to psychogenic tears. These are tears that are caused by strong emotions and physical pain. It might be stresses at work or at home, a family member passing away, or perhaps a pet, or maybe a painful breakup with a loved one. But psychogenic tears aren't exclusively caused by negative emotions. We can also turn on the waterworks when we're overwhelmingly happy or during an intense bout of laughter. That covers all the different types of tears. But all tears originate from the same place. All human tears are formed in the lacrimal gland. Resembling a raspberry, it sits just above your eyeball. It may be small in size, but it's easily one of the most complex systems in the whole human body. Tears are formed inside it, then the small bulbs that make up its unique shape contract to pump the tears downwards, exiting through little tubes and ending up on your eyeball. Your blinking is actually synchronized with your lacrimal glands. When a new tear is released from the gland, whether it be a basal, reflex, or psychogenic tear, you automatically and subconsciously blink. This blinking motion spreads the new tear evenly across the surface of your eye. Once a tear has covered your eyeball, it has two possible exit routes. The first is the standard route, down the lacrimalpunctum. Think of this as the drain on your kitchen sink. There are two lacrimalpunctum in each eye. They are located on the inside of your eyelids. In fact, if you're so inclined, these tiny little drainage pumps can be seen with the naked eye if you look really, really closely. Their sole job is to drain tears from your cornea once the tear has served its purpose. The tears that make their way down the lacrimalpunctum are drained down through your nose, which is why your nose gets stuffy when you cry. The second possible escape route for a tear is, of course, down your cheek. And then if you've just gone through a breakup, probably straight into a tub of ice cream. So what happens when you fill the sink up too high and it's at risk of overflowing? Well, the water goes through the overflow. And that's exactly what happens when you produce tears faster than your lacrimalpunctum can drain them away. When the lacrimalpunctum gets overloaded, the excess tears have nowhere else to go, and so they roll down your cheeks. There is a system in your brain specifically designed for dealing with emotions. It's called the limbic system. When we get emotional, the limbic system is activated. The limbic system is hardwired with our autonomic nervous system, which is the control center for the function of our internal organs. The autonomic nervous system is connected to and can control every major organ in your body, and thereby, the limbic system can influence and use this immense power. This is how emotions can affect us physically. For instance, emotions can cause shaky and clammy hands, an increased heart rate, sweating, stomach cramps, and of course, crying. But what's the point in tears? Why is it that when we get upset, the limbic system in our brain feels it necessary to alert our autonomic nervous system to command the lacrimal glands above our eyes to start rapidly producing these weird, oily, salty drops of water? Well, just like most human functions and behaviors, there's usually a solid evolutionary reason for having said function. If humans can do something, it's usually because there's a bloody good reason for it. Or at least there used to be. In this respect, crying is no different to most other human abilities. It's believed that crying also has its roots in evolution. For any ability to have survived a ruthless critic that is evolution, it must in some way be beneficial to our survival. But what are the survival benefits of crying? Well, there are actually two major benefits of turning on the waterworks, which explain why we have the ability to cry in the first place. The first benefit is that it makes us feel better. Get this, we don't actually cry because we feel sad. We cry to get over being sad. Crying is our body's own morale booster and healer of mental wounds. 90% of people report feeling happier and less stressed after crying. When you cry and someone says, "Let it out," they really mean it, because when we cry, we are quite literally crying our stresses away. Stress-causing chemicals that build up when we're under emotional tension are physically removed from the body in our tears when we cry. Crying also stimulates the release of endorphins in the brain. Endorphins are the happy hormone. They relieve stress and lift up your mood. The second benefit of crying is communication. Before humans developed language, some of the only forms of communication we had were basic noises such as laughter and sobbing. When our ancient ancestors hurt themselves or were feeling upset, the sight of tears rolling down their face will have spurred their cohorts to come to their aid. This exact same behavior can still be seen in babies today. Since babies can't talk, they use tears to communicate when something is wrong, whether it be pain, hunger, or tiredness, or perhaps they're just missing their mummy. Crying works so well to attract another's attention because humans are genetically programmed to feel sympathy for people who are in tears. Psychologists demonstrated this in a study where they digitally removed tears from pictures of people crying and monitored people's sympathetic response. All the participants judged the people in the images with tears to be sadder than in the images without tears. Studies show that crying is also good for your health. A good sob lowers your blood pressure and removes unwanted toxins from your body. There has even been evidence that crying can help to regulate your immune system. In particular, during a study, it was found that people who have recently had a good cry were less susceptible to allergic reactions and eczema. Crying is one of the most basic, yet powerful, forms of communication that we possess. It can heal your mind and your body, relieve stresses, and bring people closer together. And there's certainly no shame in that. Thanks for the view. Subscribe for more 42.